welcome to another episode of Straight Talk with Superintendent Lolli. I'm Elizabeth Lolli, and today I'm joined by Wyetta Hayden, Chief of Elementary Schools, Celeste Horner, Principal of Rosa Parks Early Learning Center, and Becky Davis, Senior Academic Coordinator for Elementary English Language Arts. Today we'll be talking about Rosa Parks Early Learning Center and other preschools in the district, the benefits of sending children to preschool, and how enrolling them at Rosa Parks or another preschool in the district will help them succeed academically for years to come. To begin our discussion today, Chief Hayden, can you please share more information about our DPS preschools?
Yes, Dr. Lolli, I'd love to. DPS offers full-day preschool, Monday through Thursday, and all DPS preschools are rated 5 stars, which means your students, our students, are receiving a high quality education from certified teachers.
Thank you. DPS preschools are offered in all of our buildings, but we do have a preschool center, an early learning center at Rosa Parks Elementary. So if we talk about the difference between sending students when they're kindergarten age or sending students when they're preschool age, Principal Horner, can you talk about why it's important that we offer these preschools, especially at an early learning center such as Rosa Parks?
Sure. Preschoolers are able to learn in a fun, creative environment. They're exposed to opportunities to grow and develop. They're being exposed to language and pre-academic skills such as pre-math, pre-literacy. They're also growing socially and emotionally when they're attending preschool. We know that students who attend preschool prior to kindergarten will do better once they get to kindergarten, and then further on they'll be more likely to hit benchmarks such as third grade reading. And so essentially, if you send your child to preschool, you're going to be setting them up for success throughout their school career.
I know as time has gone on with curriculum, we've seen a push down of curriculum, because when I was teaching many years ago, what was being taught in kindergarten is now what's being taught really in preschool. So this push down has occurred across the board in Ohio in our curriculums. And Mrs. Davis, you actually were a kindergarten teacher.
Yes.
Before you came to DPS. Can you talk a little bit about the differences that you saw between children who actually attended a quality preschool and children who didn't attend a preschool?
Absolutely. We noticed things like students who had attended preschool came ready to learn. They had speaking skills and communication skills that allowed them to talk to other students. They were able to plan stories and verbalize what they wanted to plan out. They were able to talk about books. They had print concepts like book handling, where they knew how to hold a book, turn the pages, and tell about the story. We noticed a big difference.
Thank you for sharing that. I know that there are a lot of parents, whenever we first started preschool many, many years ago in the state of Ohio, it was a tuition-based type preschool, and parents had a choice to pay for their students to come a half day, a whole day, or not at all. And the argument that tended to occur whenever we would talk to parents about preschool and the opportunities was that if I send my child as a 4-year-old or as a 3.5-year-old to preschool, I'm going to be cutting into their unstructured playtime, and they're not going to be able to spend that time just being a child. Principal Horner, can you talk a little bit about why that argument really, really needs to be reconsidered?
Absolutely. One of the great things about sending preschoolers to one of our 5-star preschools is that they're structured in such a way that the students are having fun while they're learning. So they may feel that they're playing, but they're actually learning not only those cognitive skills and pre-academic skills that we talked about, but they're also learning how to interact with peers, how to interact with other adults that besides the adults that they're interacting with at home. So they're in an environment that's fun for them while they're learning.
And I know that in our preschools, all of our preschools are equipped with developmentally appropriate, meaning it's the right material for the age of the child. They're developmentally appropriate equipment, developmentally appropriate materials. I know that we are center-based as a preschool, and that we practice that play, that curriculum through play. Can you talk a little bit about the academic benefits, Mrs. Davis, with using, for example, a sand and water table, or using a dramatic play center, or using even a block center as part of that learning process that occurs in any of the preschools that we house?
Yes, those are awesome tools for building language development. The dramatic play center gives students a chance to, like I said, kind of act things out, to play with those characters. We can connect that to text as well. Maybe they have characters from a book that they've read and they can act that out. The block center is awesome for math support, you know, getting those early, that early shape knowledge, problem solving, learning how to build things and how to, okay, is this going to tip over? Kind of making, you know, a prediction and then checking it. Is this going to work? The same with the sand and water table. They're also getting fine motor, like sensory practice. They're using cups to measure. They're using their hands to feel the water. And then we can also link those to units of study where we're reading about water and we're reading about where you can find sand and things like that.
Thank you. I really enjoy whenever I visit Rosa Parks and our other preschools, I enjoy watching the students talk back and forth about what they're actually doing and asking them questions about why did you use that particular cup in order to pick up the sand that you were trying to measure, or why did you use that particular cup and then pour the water out? What were you thinking? What were you doing? And they always are very articulate about that. Yes. In a preschool sort of way. I know that we recently adopted the creative curriculum as our curriculum across the board for preschool. That curriculum in and of itself is well known as a quality curriculum that our teachers are trained in and that our teachers are using. Can you talk a little bit about how does that standard curriculum, that creative curriculum that's been adopted and the training that teachers have received benefits our students in our preschools?
Sure. Creative curriculum is one of the most widely used curriculums for preschool across the nation, as you mentioned. It's research-based, and the curriculum supports the development of the whole child. So it helps the teachers plan the most effective teaching for those critical early years, for their formative years. It provides a high quality environment. It provides teachers with the best tools to present the curriculum to the students. And it actually allows for every moment to be intentional.
And when you have an intentional teaching opportunity, that really means that you hone in on those skills that the student needs to have. Even though it may seem like play,
right,
you still hone in on that skill and make sure that they understand what you're trying to get across through that play environment, and making sure that they grab onto that, understand it, and move forward with that. You mentioned the terminology of the whole child. And I'd like to talk a little bit about the whole child, because I think sometimes we think that school is all academic, and that's the only piece of the child that we really are concerned about. But when you talk about the whole child, you're talking about the social, the emotional, the physical, the academic or cognitive piece, as well as the aesthetic piece of the child. So in thinking about that, Chief Hayden, what are some of the social and emotional things that the district does as a whole for preschool as well as our other grades in making sure that we are looking at that whole child and development of that whole child?
Well, we have a lot of things in place, especially for that social emotional piece in our preschools, in their socially conscious discipline and the way they embrace as a group. It's nice to watch the kids come in the morning. They have a choice of how they would like to be greeted. They have a choice of like how they want to greet others. When I was there one day, and it was the cutest thing, one of the students had been absent, and they all took turns talking about how they missed them and they're glad they were back. That builds community. That teaches children how to be friends with other children, and that just enhances the classroom because we're a group, as opposed to just being the little 4 or 5 year old that's not used to sharing. They learn a lot of life lessons in that, and the foundation that we get in preschool that addresses the whole child actually gives them a stronger foundation for the kindergarten piece and the rest of the primary years. It's critical that we begin screening right away physically, emotionally, mentally, so that we can give students whatever kind of assistance. We can be intentional and strategic about what we offer them, because we take the time to assess the needs of the whole child. That's very important in preschool. And that's something that you do not get if you stay at home. We have experts that can actually help in these types of assessments, which will prepare you and help that child to make that transition to kindergarten, because those supports will already be in place.
Thank you. And I know that you mentioned conscious discipline. Mm-hmm. For the parents in the audience, Principal Horner, could you talk to us a little bit about what does conscious discipline actually mean? I mean, that's kind of a strange word. Conscious discipline, is somebody unconscious when they discipline children? But seriously, what does that actually mean?
Sure. Conscious discipline is a research-based approach. And it's really, there are a lot of parts to conscious discipline. Chief Hayden mentioned some of the things that they do, such as the school family, building the sense of community, wishing well people who are not there. And it's really about teaching children to handle their emotions, as opposed to just being punitive. I know that some people are afraid to send their child to school for fear, you know, of a punitive approach should their child not follow directions or participate, because this is their first school experience. But with conscious discipline, we're really talking to the child about how they feel and helping them manage their emotions.
So are teachers trained in conscious discipline?
Yes, they're required to take a number of hours of training every year in conscious discipline. And there are some intensive, ongoing professional development throughout the year in conscious discipline.
Okay. And does it seem to work?
Yes.
For students?
Yes, and it's interesting because a lot of my teachers talk about how they use it at home with their children. They use it with their spouses. Because, you know, sometimes we have to regulate ourselves.
Self-regulation, those strategies will help those students as they move into kindergarten.
Right.
You know, you'll see them using those strategies to, like you said, regulate that behavior, and that will help them as they're moving into the school-aged years.
Right, and it teaches them how to interact with each other, because, you know, where maybe if someone took your toy, your response is to jerk it back or to hit them. You know, they teach the children the language to express, I didn't like it when you did that, you know, and how to share and those sorts of things.
And by actually implementing something like conscious discipline as opposed to a punitive or a punishment approach, we also, I think, when we consider it, we actually are teaching children that you don't have to punish, you don't have to punish someone as you grow.
Right.
You don't have to get back at someone. You can actually work through those emotions and calm yourself, as well as have a rational discussion with others, which
exactly.
I think really is a great skill as we move even further than kindergarten, as we move all
Absolutely.
The way through elementary and move through the middle school years and the high school years as well. So I think that lays a great foundation for the future for our students with a conscious discipline, the modeling and the self-awareness and self-regulation piece of conscious discipline. So I was really pleased that we actually started that a few years ago in our preschools. Mrs. Davis, one of the major benefits that we've talked about is that preschool prepares students for kindergarten, and especially in the literacy area. Can you talk a little bit about what that actually means? When you are preparing me for literacy, what does that actually entail in a preschool environment?
Absolutely. What you'll see is, like we've talked about a little bit so far, building those language skills, because language and things like oral story planning are those first building blocks to becoming a writer. Understanding that print has meaning, you know, taking a favorite book and being able to tell a story based on those pictures builds that sense of story, so that later the student can go on to generate their own stories when they're in school. But in kindergarten and preschool, you're going to see them telling that story, planning it out. You'll also see lots of wordplay that's going to help them in kindergarten, like rhyming play. You know, if your name starts with B, line up, you know, things that play around with sounds that build foundational skills that are critical to early learning and early literacy skills.
Thank you for sharing that. I know that with COVID-19, we have missed a lot of our kindergartners, a lot of our preschoolers actually coming to school. Many of our preschoolers have returned with the March 1st date, as well as our kindergartners have returned. If we were to think about the impact that not having those early years, especially the preschool time, and then moving into kindergarten, what do you think some of the effects are that we will see if we don't really get our kindergartners fully back in, and our most importantly our preschoolers back in for those early skills? What are you thinking might be some outcomes of that?
Well, I think just going to school to start with can be overwhelming, and I know that our kids have suffered some trauma, and they've been overwhelmed with just the COVID and all the things going on in the world. So I'm confident that the coping skills, the social emotional skills that come inside conscious discipline, along with the literacy skills, will definitely make a difference when that child goes into kindergarten. Kindergarten is a little bit more structured than preschool, but if you haven't been in preschool long enough to sit down at a table and share, it's really hard for you to sit at a desk for maybe 30 minutes at a time. So it's all a part of growing up, and I know for parents it's hard with your younger kids, but I'm always excited at Rosa Parks because those children are having fun, playing, and they're learning, and they don't even realize. I don't know if they realize that they're actually working with hypotheses, and they're making predictions, and they're doing really higher level skills at their level. So with all the things that our kids go through normally, and adding on all the things we've been through, preschool is essential. And we've got a lot of catching up to do. So I think it's just critical that our children are in preschool and kindergarten so we can get them ready to move on.
Absolutely.
And I think that the preschool situation is, you know, I really want to keep my child home one more year, just one more year, because it goes too fast. But I really believe that with a four-day preschool, all-day mm-hmm. preschool, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, I have those opportunities with my child. I think that preschool environment is so essential to success for the students. And then I'm ready whenever I do move into kindergarten, I'm ready to take off and do what I need to do. And I will not be 2 to 3 years behind my age mate peers that are in those classes mm-hmm. with me yes. because I've had those experiences as a 3.5-year-old, as a 4-year-old, and I've also had the opportunities that have come with those extra experiences in preschool. We like for our parents to be highly involved with our children, so that's part of it too. We do workshops and things like that for our preschool parents so they understand how they can extend the learning at home, how they can continue what's happened in school, making sure that their children have a balance of that play learning time at home, as well as reading to them continuously, because vocabulary develops for a child very, very early on. And if we aren't developing that vocabulary, we find children have struggles with reading. We find that children have struggles with writing. Mm-hmm. So that whole idea of talk and that whole idea of language development that you've both have spoken about is essential. And I think that preschool yes. provides for that. I'd like to thank you for joining us today for the conversation about preschool and especially about Rosa Parks. If you want to enroll your child now for preschool, we are open for enrollment for both right now as well as for the coming year. Please call our Student Enrollment Center at 937-542-5555 and schedule an appointment. It's extremely important that your child attend preschool so that they're well prepared for kindergarten, first grade, second grade, and actually that they're well prepared for what they'll face in life, because early learning is the key to success for all students. So please make that conscious decision and attend, have your child attend the preschool, enroll your child in preschool for this year and for next year. And any other year that you have a child that needs to be enrolled. It's essential to their learning and to their success. Thank you for joining us for this episode of Straight Talk with Dr. Lolli. We appreciate you being here, and thank you very much.